Information disclosure is a common regulatory tool used to incentivize firm behavior. Because many dimensions of quality or performance are difficult to observe, making information public can be an effective means of forcing change. For example, research has shown that requiring restaurants to display inspection grades in their windows leads to improvements in hygiene and a corresponding decline in foodborne illness. Within this broader category, a particular form of disclosure publicly tags only the lowest quality firms. The idea is that shaming the worst offenders not only pressures them to improve their behavior, but, more importantly, can act as a general deterrent. Even without being targeted, other firms may improve their own behavior in order to avoid similar negative publicity in future. How effective is regulation by shaming? Do these policies incentivize broader changes? This paper studies those questions through the lens of the Occupational Safety and Health Administration. OSHA, as the agency is more commonly known, sets and enforces workplace safety and health standards in the US. This is an important regulatory setting. In 2015, there were 3.7 million work-related injuries and illnesses nationwide, and these incidents cost an estimated $250 billion per year. To monitor employers' compliance with OSHA standards, the agency relies on site visits, during which an inspector reviews paperwork and tours a facility's operations. Citations are issued for each violation observed, and financial penalties are determined thereafter. Importantly, after an inspection, OSHA can issue a press release to publicize non-compliance at a particular facility. For much of the 2000s, each of OSHA's regional offices set their own criteria for when to issue press releases. While some did so when the penalties exceeded a certain cutoff, others effectively never issued them at all. In May 2009, however, the agency's national headquarters standardized these criteria and instituted common cutoffs across all regions. This policy change substantially increased the number of press releases issued, as well as broader media coverage of OSHA violations. So did this increase in negative publicity induce more firms to change their behavior? To isolate the causal impact of negative publicity at one facility on the behavior of its peers, the author compares cases where the penalties levied on the target fall just on either side of the press release cutoff. This figure shows that the probability of having a press release jumps by 20 to 25 percentage points as soon as penalties cross the threshold. Note that this strategy hinges on the assumption that whether penalties end up just above or just below the cutoff is as good as random. These figures support that assertion by showing that, despite the sharp jump in the probability of a press release, the distribution of penalties is actually smooth around the cutoff. This indicates that neither facilities nor inspectors are gaming the system to ensure that cases fall just above or just below the threshold. The results show that publicizing the target facility's violations leads to substantial declines in non-compliance among its peers. To the right of the press release cutoff, peer facilities have a lower number of violations recorded and a lower amount of financial penalties levied following the target's inspection. In other words, even without being penalized themselves, facilities improve their behavior when one of their peers is subjected to negative publicity. The magnitude of these effects is large. A single press release leads to 73% fewer violations at peer facilities. In contrast, other research has estimated that a typical OSHA inspection leads to only 48% fewer violations at the same facility in future. The results imply that OSHA would have to conduct an additional 210 inspections in order to achieve the same improvement in compliance as is achieved with a single press release. To shed light on the mechanisms driving these effects, the author considers the role of workers. One reason facilities may want to avoid being publicly tagged as non-compliant is to prevent workers from using the negative publicity to push for higher wages and better conditions. This implies that workers' bargaining power matters. Facilities should be more sensitive to the threat of negative publicity when workers are more empowered to make demands. The author tests this idea by examining whether the effectiveness of press releases depends on the strength of local labor unions. And, indeed, when the sample is split between counties with above and below median unionization rates, press releases are only effective at reducing non-compliance in high unionization areas. Put another way, in the context of OSHA violations, facilities only respond to the threat of negative publicity when labor unions are relatively strong and workers have substantial bargaining power. In conclusion, this paper provides evidence that regulation by shaming can be effective. In this setting, the mere threat of negative publicity was sufficient to change firms' behavior. This is notable given the severe budget constraints faced by many regulators, including OSHA. While inspections form the backbone of the agency's monitoring efforts, in practice, their number is quite limited. In 2016, only 75,000 inspections were conducted, covering less than 1% of the 8 million workplaces under their jurisdiction. This paper's findings suggest that in this, as well as in other regulatory settings, using a targeted information disclosure as a complement to traditional enforcement can be an inexpensive, yet highly effective way of improving compliance. To read more on this topic, you can check out the paper's references to other related work. This includes other papers on the effects of information disclosure on firm performance, those exploring the effects of shaming in other domains, including individual tax delinquency, and finally, research on the determinants of regulatory compliance in firms.